questions that perhaps are brought up in connection with the talks relate also to the panel that we had after Inti's talk, and maybe some of the questions can actually then be discussed together with the other contributions, because I think they really are very nicely intertwined and can be perhaps positioned on, or addressed from different angles. But it's a very great pleasure to introduce Inti Guerrero now, who's currently the fourth curator with the emphasis on Latin American art at the Tate Gallery, which has the long title as Trevita de Wronski, adjunct curator of Latin American art at the Tate in London. He's co-curator of another thing that I won't be able to pronounce, which is the short title of but it's the fourth Salon National, the National Salon of Artists in Pereira, which is in Colombia. And he's the curator of the 38th IVA International Islands Fair in Limerick, opening in April 2018. From 2011 to 2014, he was the Associate Artistic Directing Curator of Tiro Retica, an independent non-profit space founded in 1999 in San Jose, Costa Rica. He has curated multiple exhibitions all over the world. We can also say it just says Latin America, Europe, and Asia, but he's based in Hong Kong, and I think the exhibition that he's going to introduced to us today is one that he has been involved in and shows very much the kind of argument that we're addressing of this idea of referencing exhibitions with exhibitions and through exhibitions. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much to both you and Rike and for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here in Norway. This is my second time. 2 years ago, I was in Bergen as part of the Bergen Assembly. No, 3 years ago, yeah. It's a triennial. And I'm also happy to know that most of you have an artist background and that the curatorial interest and inquiry is in the context of, I guess it's an art school, yes, primarily artists. In the room. I bring that up because I was trained as an artist and curating came within the curriculum, and somehow as time went by I let go of my practice as an artist, but understanding that curating or the exhibition was also a medium as other mediums, and that they are creative spaces for discourse and ideas, and this is one of the most recent projects that I've done, and it's related to an exhibition that happened in the 80s, and I'll just guide you through a little bit of the context geographically and the institution where the exhibition happened, so that you also get an idea of where all of this comes from. So, yes. So the exhibition I will talk about happened between Teoretica, the art center that we just mentioned, and Tate Modern in 2014. Under the invitation of Tate Modern, Teoretica was one of other institutions that were invited to an exhibition series that occurred in one exhibition space that you'll later see at the Level 1 gallery for over 3 years. The Tate wanted to connect with scenes that they regularly do not have in their programs, and geographically that means. So in their venture, they connected to art spaces, artist-run or independent spaces, nonprofit foundations, to co-curate an exhibition together. And we were invited by the Tate, and I co-curated the show with a curator at the Tate called Shared Mapia. That's a little bit of institutional framework. But So Teoretica was founded in 1999 in Costa Rica. Some of you who might not be familiar with the geography of Central America. Central America is between Colombia, which is in South America, and Mexico. And so all of these smaller countries, Costa Rica is right after Panama. And it was founded in the 90s, very symptomatic to a time of post-war. As you might be familiar with, throughout the 70s and 80s and early 90s, different countries in Central America were at war, different civil wars happening by either left-wing guerrillas or left governments that were taken down by military coups, all of them through American interests, and therefore there was a huge American artillery and armor that was sent to either governments fighting left-wing guerrillas or paramilitary groups that were armed in different parts of that region. This is just an image of a still of a video of a great filmmaker called Frank Pineda. This is not part of the show, it's just for you to have a reference. I highly recommend you to Google him. His films are on YouTube, and they pretty much convey the atmosphere of terror and repression at the time. And a photographer that is widely known in the West for documenting that period in Central America was the photographer Susan Meiselas, and primarily in Nicaragua and El Salvador. Now, all of these wars that were scattered around throughout the region had a peace process in 1987, although Guatemala, the war actually ended in the early 90s, and the main person behind the peace process was the president of Costa Rica, Oscar Arias, who was a winner, a laureate of the Nobel Peace Prize in 1987 here in Norway. The reason why Costa Rica kind of became the peacekeeper of the region was because Costa Rica was never had a civil war, and therefore it acted as that peacekeeper, and its president became the main voice of that peace process. This is to give you a context on why the 90s was a post-war period for the region, and Teoretica, which is this physically, these two houses, was kind of brought in a moment where many international foundations, European foundations primarily, wanted to give funds through different fields, either economic, social, culture, to Central America. And Virginia Pérez Ratón, who is an artist, trained as an artist, and back then acting as a curator of a museum, saw the context and the opportunity to create a space that would be funded by all these European founders and American founders that wanted to give stability to Central America, and therefore the space began in the context of giving a platform and a voice to contemporary artists from that region, from Guatemala, El Salvador, and Costa Rica being the center of that regional voice. That's one context of why that happened in Costa Rica, or why such an institution emerged in San Jose. But the idea of Central America in Costa Rica goes earlier, before the context of the wars of the 80s and the 90s. This is just something that is representative of how Costa Rica embraced a regional discourse to understand its national foundation. This is the monument of, celebrating the national monument of Costa Rica, but what you see is a scene where the statues are female allegories, each representing a country from the region. So one woman would be Nicaragua, one woman would be Guatemala, another woman would be El Salvador, and they are chopping the head of Mr. Walker, an American invader from California, who invaded Nicaragua, and all the nations, neighboring nations, went to fight the invaders, the American invaders, and therefore it became kind of like the real independence of Central America. The reason why Californian so-called filibusteros invaded Central America was because when the Spanish left, what was between Mexico and Colombia was a bit unstable. Nobody really knew who was in power, and Californian businessmen saw the opportunity and invaded, and Costa Rica took this as its national monument. That's the day that this happened in the 19th century is the day that is celebrated as the National Day in Costa Rica. So again, that's the context of both the wars in the 80s and the post-war period, and this very long idea that the national is referred to the regional. Now, this anti-imperialism or anti-Americanism is very close to the exhibition that we started with Xavier Mapin, the curator at Tate. So when we were invited by the Tate, the exhibition that somehow, the exhibition that preceded the one that we did, as I said, throughout 3 years, the Tate had already invited other art spaces from either Latin America, Southeast Asia, and Africa to co-curate a project together. They tended to have an idea of showing the art scene from those contexts, no, as a way of exposure, because it was London, it was a way to show what was hot or happening in that place. And we somehow did not want it to fall into that mechanism of just showing who is who of Central America now, but rather to understand why are we doing this exhibition, for who are we doing it, and what is the context of Tate to do the exhibition. It's important that the exhibition happened first at Tate and then travel to Costa Rica. So primarily was thought for the viewer in London. So we took as a point of departure an exhibition that happened in the 80s by Group Material. As you know, Group Material was founded and many artists were part of it, but primarily figures like Felix Gonzalez Torres would be one of the most famous figures that later came out as an individual artist. And but of course Julie Ault and Doug Ashford, who are still very active, especially as scholars. And when in the 80s, when Felix Gonzalez Torres was not part of the group, they made an exhibition in the context of a more wider artist solidarity platform that happened at that time in 1983, 1984, which was called Artist Call. And the Artist Call was an artist call for solidarity to the wars in Central America and against the American intervention in the US, American intervention in Central America. And as you could see, the people behind this platform were very well-known artists. Now that we spoke about the canon in Cosmin's talk, it's clearly that these figures are part of the Western canon of modern contemporary art history. And Louis Bourgeois, Klaus Oldenburg, Barbara Kruger, or who felt at that time committed to something that was happening in a place that they probably had never visited. And we'll talk a little bit about what that means. And it was within that context of the artist call that group material made an exhibition in PS1 called Timeline, a Chronicle of U.S. Interventions in Central America. And it was the first timeline before the AIDS timeline. I don't know if you've studied before group material, but they're very famous for having done a timeline on AIDS, and it became, like this milestone of also how can an installation become an exhibition, and artists making curatorial work through an experimental format of exhibition design and of understanding how works can be displayed chronologically through another idea of chronology. So what they did in PS1, back then PS1 was a non-profit artist-run space, it was not part of MoMA, was that in all its galleries, they placed a long red line, and in each, every meter or two, a date appeared. And the date went from a date from the 19th century till then, 1984, as you can see there in the image, which referred to a date when the U.S. had intervened military in Latin America, either through a coup, an invasion, sending armor, etc. No? Yet they asked artists to send works that could react or be representative of that date. And as you can see, some of the works would be maybe more propaganda look or politically or more directly seen as political art. But the whole spectrum of the political was open in a way that works that could be completely abstract in image could insinuate a certain association with the date that that happened. And there was also non-artwork. For example, the curators decided to place on the floor of the exhibition the commodities that somehow were the main forces or the reasons why America, the U.S. had interest in Latin America. So there was coffee and bananas on the floor. And this is just another image. So this archive that you're seeing is now in NYU. Group material before they when each of its participants took their own lives and paths. They donated their archive to NYU, and it's a very interesting mandate. They basically, when we approach them, they send us like this paragraph of kind of like an ethics of what they left for any researcher, curator, or artist when they encounter this archive, where basically they give free way of interpretation and of reenactment. And so with this liberty, and obviously still keeping a dialogue, especially with Doug Ashford, we started to think of the exhibition. Now, it's important that the exhibition, although the beginning of the show does exhibit literally the archive, the show in itself, it's more a way to create like a, to activate that archive and or a mining of that archive. So I'll just give you, there's some just few slides to give you a sense of this material. And these are images from the show in Teoretica, so after it went to Tate. Something important again, when all this archive was shown at Tate and people would read that some of this material and letters would be signed by Barbara Kruger or Louise Bourgeois. As a visitor, our exhibition was on the first floor, right at the entrance, so our idea would be that people would see that Louis Bourgeois in the 80s was part of this artist school, and then on the second floor they would actually see a Louis Bourgeois installation. So it was kind of like that institutional connection. Of course, in Teoretica, it was another context. So yeah, this is just other material, and we found incredible archives that we just thought, well, people just have to know this. So Lucy Lee Park was very involved, and she wrote not only on that exhibition, but on a previous exhibition that was also part of the artist call. And this is some installation shots at the Tate. And the difference with how we work with the archive and the visuality of a group material with Teoretica is that, as you can see, the red line was recreated not only inside, but actually, outside, and coming out to the institution, and some of this archive material went to the facade of the institution. This, for example, is the list of dates with the description that they refer to. So every year, which you saw in the PS1 installation, comes from this list of invasions, coup d'etats, etc. Originally, we found it in the catalog of PS1, but as I said, with the library that group material gave us, we decided to place it on the facade of the institution, including the poster, which has this very interesting iconography, making borrowing the image of Vietnam. And I'll just read this because I think it gives a sense of like their militants. So it's called, "Artist Call Against U.S. Intervention in Central America is a nationwide mobilization of artists organizing out of New York City. A huge series of exhibitions and events will be centered around January 22nd, which is the 52nd anniversary of the 1932 massacre in El Salvador, which marked the beginning of the systematic destruction of the Salvadorian culture. In conjunction with the INALS, INALCE, the Institute for the Arts and Letters of El Salvador in Exile, and in cooperation with the ASTC, the Sandinista Association of Cultural Workers, Artist Call will jointly exhibit art from Central America, art about Central America, and art in support of Central America as a political and aesthetic strategy to call attention to Central American issues. Artist Call represents the outrage of thousands of artists and intellectuals concerned with the repression of the crucial cultural rights of all people." Now, that poster was made by Klaus Altenburg. So you can see the level of solidarity and affiliation of very well-established artists with that time and that place. Now, perhaps that exhibition and the rhetoric that you just read, more than being connected directly to Central America itself, it might be widely connected to a tradition in the US that arises after or during Vietnam, which is an anti-war citizen. Maybe these artists and intellectuals in New York were somehow a second wave of anti-war Americans that came from the anti-war Vietnam context. But it's still incredible and impressive that all of these people were talking about this region and were committed to this region. As you might know, and maybe people in the floor even had friends, Nicaragua was the only country that was victorious, in the sense the left actually won and created a revolution, and many intellectuals, including then Doug Ashford, went to Nicaragua. When we made the exhibition at Tate, Chris Durkin actually told us, "I also went to Nicaragua." So it became like this idea of hope, but nowadays that government that one became super corrupt and evangelical, so everything went wrong. Now, in 10 minutes, I'm going to just give you an idea of what type of other works were part of the show, because as I said, the show was not an expose of archival material, so it was not this fetishism of the past or of exhibition history, but trying to dig through some of those dates that appeared in group material and see how artists still today are interested in those moments and making work on those moments or on larger notions of intervention, of culturally foreign intervention, which you will see at the end. So there were two works that were related to the context of Panama and the Panama Canal. These are not images of the artist, this is just a little of context. The Panama Canal might be the most radical moment of that American intervention in the US. It was a plot of land that was bought by the US to what was then Colombian territory. And it was perhaps still the most Herculean engineer project in Western history, to literally divide a continent and join the two, well, one sea and an ocean. What you see to the right is an image that celebrates an anniversary of the construction of the Panama Canal. It happened in San Francisco. It was, this is like the poster of that, it was like a world exhibition that celebrated the construction of the Panama Canal. And here literally you see that representation of that Herculean effort to divide land. All of this material was gathered by Magali Arriola, this archival documentation in her biennial in 2008 in Panama, the 8th Panama Biennial, which was based on revisiting the construction of the Panama Canal. And artists were asked to, were commissioned to make work based on their own research on the construction of the canal. This is the cover of the of that biennial, which I find extremely funny. As you can see, it's a beauty pageant contest. A Miss Canal Zone is Caucasian, and Miss Panama to the right is more mulatto or darkened skin. You know, and this clearly shows that there was a clear division of territory and. Jurisprudencia, I don't have my English. Jurisprudency? I don't know.
Jurisprudence or jurisdiction?
That. And within researching that biennial, we came across two works that we included in the show. This is a still of an artist from Panama called Humberto Vélez. It's a film that he shot in 8mm of a 90-year-old bodybuilder. I say again, 90-year-old. And because it's shot in 8mm, black and white, and because it's a very old man with a lot of muscle, there is a temporal ambiguity of what you're seeing. When he is showing your back, you really think that the film is a vintage film from the 1910s or 1920s, but then he turns around and there's something that doesn't really quite match. And the work, as its title refers, The Last Builder, it's referring to a myth that still goes around in Panama that you can still encounter in downtown Panama, the last builder of the Panama Canal. As you might know, or don't know, the Panama Canal was built primarily by African and Asian cheap labor. A lot of people died making that canal of malaria. Actually, the French, who actually wanted to make the canal before the Americans and failed because of malaria, when it happened, this is out of my script, but I just remember. A lot of people went to, a lot of French civilians went to build that canal, including Gauguin, on his way to Polynesia. Yeah. Anyway. So another work that was part of the biennial and that we included was a work by Michael Stevenson. He's from New Zealand but lives in Berlin. And that's also important in relation to the show, that the exhibition not only included artists from Central America, as I said at the beginning, one of our interests was not to fall into that idea of presenting or showcasing and promoting the art scenes of Central America, but speaking of something that happened in Central America through artists that either were from there or artists from other latitudes that had made work in that region or about that region. I guess it, now that I say it, it follows a bit the poster of Klaus Oldenburg, no? That that it's either with artists from Central America, on Central America, or about Central America. Anyway, so to make it short, this film is 10 minutes. It's what you see. It's a game of cards, and there's a voiceover. The voiceover is mixing different sources of bibliographical material. One of them is a book on mathematical probability, which was written by the chief of security of Torrijos in the 1970s. And Torrijos was the general military president of Panama, who forced Jimmy Carter to sign an agreement that the Panama Canal will be given back to Panama at the turn of the century, in 1997, at the end of the 90s, or in 2000, and which actually happened. And the chief of security of the general, no, was a mathematician, a trained mathematician. He was he published books on probability. And what Michael Stevenson did was that he used the language found in this book to make his own narrative about the different probable possibilities that could have happened in the 1970s in Panama. And so there are many narratives that come across. One of the most interesting ones, and I'll send you the link, or we'll find a way for you to see it, is related to the moment when the Shah of Iran was in exile in Panama, and Torrijos had a very direct relationship with the Shah and used him somehow to also play the US. And everything in Michael Stevenson's research becomes like this associations, possible associations, where what would have happened if the Shah would have died in Panama, maybe the American hostages would have da-da-da-da, and then maybe Reagan wouldn't have won, and everything starts to collide, but it's all related to what was happening in Panama in the 1970s. Yeah, this you can see here on the subtitle, says Jimmy Carter was up for re-election, so it shows. Although what you see is only a game of cards, it's all about the context of that time. These are just images of the installation shots for you to have a reference. And of course, one of the main narratives in Central America, as you know, is the exportation of bananas, and hence also the name, the stereotype nickname of most of this country is known as banana republics, not only because they export bananas, but because of their failed states and corrupt governments. No? Now, this image is not part of the work. It's just this idea to show how bananas were needed and were also used as propaganda of progress in the first world and development for children to adults, etc. But bananas in the third world, actually, or the farming of bananas in the third world, have a very dark history and association. And this is a painting by Deborah Arango, which we wanted for the exhibition, but it was impossible to bring it, but there's a way how a PowerPoint can also be an exhibition. So in this exhibition, Deborah Arango made this painting in 1948, and the painting refers to a very iconic image, which primarily in Colombia and in Guatemala have this moments throughout early 20th century where workers from banana plantations who wanted to syndicalize and went to protest ended up killed in massacres. And even García Márquez, if you remember, in 100 Years of Solitude, he narrates how the train of the banana plantations one day came back with corpses rather than branches of bananas. Deborah Arango makes up various drawings, watercolors like this ones and paintings, referring to that image, but it's obviously an image that has a universal iconography of genocide. And obviously it's 1948, and it would be very strange for not associating it to the Holocaust or the images of the Holocaust that the artist must have seen back then. Now, this train and the relationship of bananas and massacres was more discussed by work by Andreas Siegmann from Germany. Some of you might have seen his work in Bergen 3 years ago. He made a work making a visual representation of infograms, I don't know how you call them in English, yeah, infograms, which is very representative of his practice, trying to make a visual representation of data related to how the United Fruit Company had systematically been involved in the massacres of people, workers in Coup d'Etats. The United Fruit Company before Chiquita Banana and Doel was the main, had the monopoly of banana exportation. So UFC that you see on top is what refers to that company, United Fruit Company, which was founded in Costa Rica, but then spread through Guatemala, El Salvador, and even the coast of Colombia. Now I'm finishing two words. just to give you a context of how the exhibition was related. Regina Jose Galindo, who's an artist that you might also have seen here or other parts in Europe, working always in performance with her own body. She made a work in 2012 related or reacting to the trials that were happening in that time in Guatemala that were basically making a point that there was a genocide in the wars in the 1980s, an indigenous genocide, and the testimony that she decided to make this work on was a testimony about how a village had heard a bulldozer arrive to their village one night before the killings. So that was the key element to the trial, which made it a fact that it was previously planned, the killings, and there was a systematic engineering of the Machiavellic project of killing and making an ethnic cleansing to an indigenous community, to a specific indigenous community in Guatemala. Now, the context of Guatemala is very important. I just gave you here some images for you to get a sense of that country in that war. In the 1950s, the president, Arbenz, was perhaps the first socialist president that was taken down by the CIA before Allende. You have this idea that, yeah, Allende would be the first. It was clearly, yes, the communist socialist elected president that was taken down by the Americans. But Arbenz, although with a military background, his social reforms, which included nationalizing many American companies related to United Company, to United Fruit Company, led to his to the coup d'etat that took down his government. Now, that coup d'etat is not the coup d'etat that you see to the right. There was a series of unstable political regimes, but it is this one in the 80s by Rios Montt, which definitely was the most violent and the one that actually made the genocide, that created the genocide that the work of Regina José Galindo is referring to. Those testimonies that Regina José Galindo is referring in her work were the main gave way to a trial to the general in 2013. That's Rios Montt on his trial, and the people that you see in the back are victims of the period that he was the president of Guatemala. Sadly, although the trial decided 80 years in prison for Rios Montt, it was overturned by the main court, and it's now again in process. Anyway, that's the context, and maybe I'll skip this. Yeah, this was another work on bananas, but I think it's interesting that we made works on bananas, but no bananas were visually in the exhibition. Because there's a lot of work in Central America and throughout Latin America that actually have literally bananas represented graphically, visually in their works. But all of these are taking the subject through other forms. This is the work of Oscar Figueroa, that he uses the plastic that is used to cover banana plantations and makes monochromes with that material. And this is the last work, which is more of takes a larger scope on the idea of intervention, and it's not related to the U.S. Dichotomy with Latin America, but it's perhaps even more complicated. It's the work of Nafu Ramirez Figueroa. He is actually a Guatemalan exile. Because of the wars, his family, when he was young, went to Canada. And he came back to Guatemala to make amazing, interesting work. This is one of them. A Brief History of Architecture is a dance that I'll just play it, and we can end it with that. Okay. Siempre juntos means in English always together. Thank you. focuses the artist in the middle, and the work is referencing, well, three architectural languages that are simultaneously existing in present Guatemala, but is representative of the different cultural lineages that occur in Latin America, and the frictions and the violence that might be associated to that on a not so positive marriage between these three lineages, no? So one would be an architecture referencing a colonial ecclesiastical architecture, which is the church, the Marquette figured as a church. The other one would be the lineage representing the millenary culture of the Mayas, and represented by a pyramid from the 200 to 900 year before Christ, after Christ. And the other one would be the modernist building of an international style, referencing the idea of progress and development, no? But also with a local touch that always happened in the process of modernity in Latin America. What I'm referring to is that although it is a modernist internationalist style building, the facade is a mosaic of a modernist Guatemalan painter, which has some codes of certain locality, no? So Nafus shows us that they end up destroying themselves. And how we showed this at the Tate was the video was in the Cube TV there to the left, and the maquettes were left on the floor. And we placed them there with Shire because when people saw the exhibition, as you can see, the window that is outside leads to the Millennium Bridge, where you can see St. Paul, which is also like an architectural language of power and dominance, no? And I think that's it. Thank you. Thank you. I just did it. You know what? While I'll talk, I think, because I was trying to download Regina Jose Galindo, so maybe I'll just leave it there while I speak, while we do questions. Yep. We can ask the question.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. We thought maybe we have the possibility to have a couple of questions now and take some others with us to the next panel discussion, but who would like to start with the question? Well, if nobody does, then maybe I do.
Okay.
I'm very interested in this idea of taking the book material to a new venue or to a new existence, but I'm interested in the status of the original show. How would you describe that? Because you could look at it as an assemblage of material that you reuse now. You could use it as a context that produced a certain cultural argument, where you take the argument and you reuse it, but you could also, and this would be the more traditional, where you could use it as an artwork, so to speak, and reset it,
yeah,
and reinstall it. Maybe you could elaborate a little bit on that, how you looked at it.
Well, I think that what's interesting of this, if it is a historical object, is that raw material left us kind of a mandate of that experimentality, you know? So I would think that restaging it as when attitudes become form would totally be contrary to the idea of how group material understood the possibilities of exhibition making. It's also this idea in the sense of the timeline that when they make the timeline, it's meant also to be continuous. Although they ended in 1984, it was because they were in 1984. But I think that their language and their introduction to understanding how could an exhibition happen was that it could make a chronology elastic, and not only because of more years, but through the different narratives and constellations that the artworks that were associated to could take you to. No? So I think that at the end, they were very conscious of that, and that's why they, when I say they, it's Doug Ashford. That's why Doug Ashford immediately replied saying like, it's there, do what you want. It's not, we're not the writers of our history. You know? So I think it happens because they said it, but I think it also should happen in any case, because we never see the art historical object through the eyes of the contemporary back then. No? So, like in Cosman's presentation as well, the idea was not to reenact the same atmosphere of the art space made by Frodkin in the 1980s in New York, because obviously you would never accomplish that. No? So it would be more on how to actually activate or create even more bifurcations after having encountered that archive, you know, that material.
Well, there's no immediate question, then I would say. Let's perhaps continue that discussion.
Yeah. May I just ask one quick question?
Yes.
Talking about archive in group materials archive, did any of this what you produced find an entry into the group material archive?
Mm-hmm,
so it's a very kind of obvious question, but
does it? Yeah. It should. Maybe we should donate this material to NYU to include it, so that it's. Well, yeah. Maybe I should ask them. Yeah.
Yeah, but maybe, again, that might be a topic that we could continue in the panel, but I think there is such a difference between the original venue and the original way that the group material show was made up to the Tate as a context, and then back to the actual site where the conflicts were happening, that maybe it's not a good idea. Because I think it lives from the difference, if at all.
Yeah, and you pointed out something that wasn't further discussed, was about like what was the reaction of bringing it to Central America, like the exhibition itself. And a lot of people in Latin America don't know of that installation by Group Material. Well, a lot of people in general, it's kind of like a rare work. Only, like, I think it was in 2011 that there was an article by After All that kind of like brought it up again to the conversation. But to many people there, it was still like, oh, this idea there was still this very antagonistic anti-imperialism, like, oh, the Americans and us not understanding that, well, not only in this case that there were American intellectuals who felt a solidarity with the context, but that there was also, in the 70s and 80s, it was also hard in the US, you know? Like, there's this blindness of an Orthodox left in Latin America that doesn't address the struggles that were happening in the US in the 70s and 80s as well, no? That there was also guerrilla, that there was also protests in universities, you know? So, primarily, yeah, people in the art world didn't know that Louis Bourgeois or Barbara Kruger were thinking of Central America, no? So that it also made sense to make it in Costa Rica.
Well, thank you very much again. Then I think we do the film now, switch from one to the other, and then have the panel discussion directly after the film for Q&A.
5 minutes, thank you, to switch.
Okay, do you want to use the 5 minutes for the whatever? We have 5 minutes for the installment.